Good morning, church. It is great to be with you again. Did you know the Australian Institute of Health and Welfare tell us that 13 million Australians have eye defects, meaning that they have visual impairment? Now, the vast majority of those can have glasses. I fall into the category. I wear glasses, so I would fall into that the category. And the majority of those have got aids that can assist them, and some of them can get surgery that repairs their eyesight. But nonetheless, in a population the size of Australia, that is 51% of the people have some sort of a disability with their eyesight. Less than 1% is legally blind, but still, that's an incredibly large amount of people who have eyesight problems. And you might not fall into that category. Maybe you've got 20/20 vision. But even people with 20/20 vision can temporarily experience blindness. By that I mean, let's say you go from a dark area to a light area, or a light area to a dark area. Let's say you've just been watching a movie and you walk out, it was a matinee, you're in there, and you walk out of this dark, dark room where you've been watching a movie and straight into the sunlight. And for a moment, it's hard to adjust. Your vision's not quite there, right? Conversely, let's say you've been in a light area. Let's say you've been out in the garden for an hour, working away in the heat of the day, the brightest part of the day, and then you walk straight inside a room, inside a house that's been locked up, closed up, and it's dark. And you can experience this sense of, goodness me, where's the lights? I can't see a thing. And see, eyesight is extremely important. I mean, it's one of those sort of things that when you have it, you don't really think too much about it until you lose it. Like walking from the sunlight into a dark room. Now, have a look at this verse with me in Matthew chapter 6, verse 22 to 23. It says, "The lamp of the body is the eye. And therefore, if your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. For if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness?" How great is the darkness in you? Whew. That is a probing, difficult question to ask. You see, Jesus is actually asking it rhetorically. He doesn't want us to, answer him. He wants us to stop, contemplate what he's saying, and take correct action. He's saying, if what you think is light is in fact darkness, are you aware of how dark it's really become? And that's what Jesus is saying. If the eye is bad and you think that you're in the light, but in fact, because your eyes are bad, your eyesight is bad, you're not aware that you're in darkness, how will you know how dark the darkness is inside you? And of course, he's not talking about natural eyesight. I mean, we can observe the principle through observing natural eyesight, but he's talking about spiritual darkness. And if you think you're in the light, but in fact you're in the darkness because your eyes have become so dim, your spiritual eyes have become so adjusted to darkness, and you become so accustomed to navigating through this darkness, thinking, I've got enough light to get my way through this life. Where, at what point, and how are you going to determine, that's enough of the darkness, I want to turn on a light? True? Because it can happen progressively. Darkness can creep in progressively, or it can happen all of a sudden. Like we just spoke about it. If it happens all of a sudden, you go from light to darkness and you think, oh my goodness, I'm disorientated, and you do something about it. But if it's like a slow and progressive darkness, you can still see and you can still see. And because of the way the eye works, of course, when you go from light to dark, the pupil opens up and allows as much light in so the brain can compute what you're trying to look at. And so this is what happens if you've adjusted to the darkness and your pupils just keep opening and opening and opening. You can fool yourself to think, I'm in the light. I'm in the light. I can see the obstacles away around me. I trip on a few things here and there, but generally I'm doing okay. It can't be that bad. But consider it. It's not just about a moment of darkness. If you're living in darkness, you're living in darkness. And you continue to adjust to the darkness so you can continue to function. But the problem is, darkness isn't just in that moment. We're talking about spiritual darkness. Let's go back to a practical example to understand how the darkness works and how what you let in through the eyes actually affects your entire life, because that's what Jesus is suggesting, is that what you let in through the eye goes into the soul. Say it's movie night and you've got a few options. One of them is a comedy. And so you put on a lighthearted comedy and it's all clean fun and all the rest. Well, when the movie's over, does the humor stop? No, it generally tends to adjust your mood, adjust your temperament. You know, you go out after the movie and you have a dinner and you're remembering some of the funny lines or some face that the comedian pulls that makes you just chuckle, and those little one-liners, and you can't wait to use them because they're just so funny. You see, it happens, it continues after the moment. What we let in through the eye gate goes down deeper than just a temporal experience. It can become quite deep, quite spiritual. Let's say you chose a different movie, not a comedy. Let's say you chose a darker movie, a thriller, a murder mystery, or worse, a horror movie. Especially if you watch it at night. That experience of horror doesn't finish when you flick off the video. When you go outside of that movie experience, that feeling, that sensation has now affected you. And for some people, that can go beyond just one night of checking under the bed in the cupboard and watching every shadow move. It can become, stir up some sort of a fear. Some people become quite fearful from watching those movies. It sticks with them. You see, what we let in through the eye gate has more effect than what we repreciate. It's not just in the moment. You could also choose something that's good for you to watch, something that goes into the eye gate. Like this morning, you've chosen to watch a sermon online. We're going to be listening to the Word of God and sharing time together. What's going in through the eye gate is going to impact you. God willing, what goes in the eye gate today will impact you for life. So what you let in through the eye gate can have a continual effect. Likewise, when you watch sermons like this, you've chosen to let something go into the eye gate that's based around the Word of God, and you're going to spend time ministering to each other and having fellowship together. What's going in is having more experience, more expression in your life than just this moment. Your life is changing and changing continually because you're letting the good stuff in through the eye gate. That's why we encourage you, read your Bible. I can't stress strongly enough, church, read your Bible. Not to become religious, but because what you let go in through the eyes is having an ongoing effect beyond that moment of reading. That's why we tell you, attend church as much as you can. Get involved in your Sunday ministry point. Get involved in the combined services. Get involved in ministry. Get involved. Open your eyes and get involved, because what you expose yourself to through the eye gate is having a greater effect on your life than you can really calculate, because it's more than just that moment. And likewise with fellowship, likewise with prayer meetings, likewise with all these things that we have to go in and visually see. Those things are impacting you more than just in that moment. And you see, setting your eyes on things can have a negative and a positive effect. And this is no new problem. This is not new to humanity at all. Turn to Genesis chapter 3, and we're going to read verse 6. So when the woman saw, did you catch that word? So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree desirable to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate. She also gave it to her husband with her, and he ate. Now, history would have read very differently. Human history would have been very different if Eve had turned to that serpent and said, "You listen to me, little snake. I know what the Word of God is. I know what he said. He said what that fruit is. He said what it will do to our lives. I'm not even going to look at it. I'm not even going to entertain your suggestion that I could become better and more like God if I eat that fruit. I'm not even going to listen to you. I'm not even going to look at that piece of fruit." Wow, how different history would be. But you see, from that original sin to every single one committed today, it all begins with just one look. And think about it, even those who know better. Most of us stumble from time to time, and we have these things that we know we shouldn't look at, we shouldn't set our eyes on. You know, envy and lust and jealousy, all those things are things that we set our eyes on. And even though we know they're not good for us, we tell ourselves, just one look, what's the harm, right? And that's where it begins. That one look turns into the second look. And the second look turns into thinking about it and wondering about it. And then thinking and wondering about it turns into fantasizing about having it or doing it or being it. And that eventually just wears you down. Your resolve wears down until eventually you stumble. You fall for it because you've been looking at it. And just like Eve, you looked at it and you contemplated it and then you grabbed it. That's the process for all of us. We look at it, we contemplate it, and we grab it. The most ironic thing of it all is after we stumbled, after we've fallen, we then go into this state of shock. It's like, how did this happen? I can't understand how this happened to me. Yeah, you do. You're just kidding yourself. You know exactly how it happened. You looked at it, you thought about it, contemplated it, and then you took it. Now, we blame others because, let's face it, no one wants to wear the blame themselves squarely, so we will blame somebody else. We'll blame our spouse or our parents or our kids or our boss or the economy or the circumstances or something else, and may even do what Adam and Eve did, which is blame God. And so I want to just clear up the idea that God is somehow responsible at all to be blamed for the choices that you're making. Turn to James chapter 1, verse 13 to 15. Verse 13 says, "Let no one say when he is tempted, 'I am tempted by God.' For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it's fully grown, brings forth death." You see, if you don't look at the temptation in the first place, it doesn't stir the desire within you. You might have all sorts of terrible desires inside you. Listen, that's part of the fallen human nature. But you have the ability to stop falling for those things if you stop taking the first look, because that look will lead to contemplation, and that contemplation will lead to you grabbing that thing that is no good for you. And I would tell you this morning, friends, stay in the light. Don't turn to look at temptation. Keep your eyes on the light. Keep your eyes on God. That's how you can stay in the light. Now, the question, of course, is risen, why don't we stay in the light? Well, Jesus answers this question quite clearly in John chapter 3. Turn with me to verses 19 and 20. "And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed." You see, Jesus goes beyond just simply telling us that some people love darkness. He explains what's truly going on, what's really going on in our hearts when we choose to walk in darkness. And it's quite simple. We find a comfort in the dark. We find a comfort because we think that our sin is not being exposed. As if the two people that really matter most can't see it, which is God and you. As if you're not aware you're sinning, and as if God's not aware you're sinning. Yet we choose to pretend like we're not being seen, and we create these little dark hidden spaces in our lives where we think that we can sin and not get exposed. But the fact is, if not now, on Judgment Day, all will be exposed. And it's crazy because darkness creates disorientation. Darkness is a place where fear breeds, the fantastic breeding ground for fear, insecurities, a lack of direction, a lack of effectiveness. That's what darkness does, that you cannot move as quickly, move as effectively, be as productive in the dark as you can be in the light. And in spite of all of the confusion that darkness causes, so many of us choose to walk in darkness instead of walking in the light. but it's your choice. And if you choose to walk in the darkness, let me tell you what it's like to be watching someone who chooses darkness. Our hearts break for you. We cry for you. We pray for you. We try to counsel you. We intercede you. But those who hate you, they're easy to pick because they're the ones that are tempting you. Because they take great delight in confusing you, great delight in deceiving you, great delight in distracting you and putting those things in your way to trip you up. They love to put hazards in your way. And I wish you'd understand that this is the danger of people that lure us into sin and temptation. Like the serpent, we think they're our buddy because we're having this conversation, but they have ill intent for you. If you've got anybody that offers you the opportunity to sin, the means to sin, you should be looking at them as an enemy because they sure as heck are not your friend. Friends are someone who wants to see the best come out of you. Your enemies are those who want to trip you up and trap you. And let me assure you, you've got plenty of people in your life who take nothing more than delight in watching you stumble. There's a universal game played all around the world. I say universal because it really is all over the globe. A game that probably you're familiar with, and in English we call it Blind Man's Bluff. And it's where one child is blindfolded and all the kids get around them and they torment them and try and call them over, and just when they're close, they take off. But I grew up in Queensland, you see. And so Blind Man's Bluff was always a popular game, but in Queensland, you spend a lot of time in the pool. We love to swim in Queensland, right? So if you can't find a swimming pool to go to, you'll find a lake or a river or a beach, or just wait till it rains and jump in a puddle. But as long as Queenslanders are in a pool, we're happy. So we sort of play Blind Man's Bluff in a pool, and we call it Marco Polo. Now, how it worked was one kid is it. Now, everyone likes to play Marco Polo, but nobody wants to be it. And it is the one that has to be blindfolded, but you don't blindfold them. They've just got to shut their eyes. And they're in the pool, and they call out, Marco. And you wait, and he waits. And he's waiting for someone to say, Polo. And you'll hear these little faint polos. Or someone over that's miles away will yell out, Polo. And the whole game is about distracting and deceiving someone. And so the idea is the kid that's it has to grab that person that's called Marco. And if they can just touch anybody, even if by accident, if they can touch somebody, that new person becomes it and they're relieved of being the it. Now, when you think about it, what makes the game interesting, what actually makes it exciting, is to be deceiving the poor it. The one that's blindfolded, the one that hasn't got a foggiest clue where they are, they're pushing their hands out everywhere, trying to find someone, anyone, hoping they don't smack into the wall of the pool. And it's fun to deceive that person, create some sort of a projected sound so they go running off into that direction, swimming off into that direction. That's what the game's about. It's actually a game of deceit. And the game itself is relatively harmless, and it's a stack of fun. You know, everyone loves playing Marco Polo. It can go on for hours till you just get totally sick of it, or one of the parents comes out and tells you all to shut up. But it's a great fun game as long as you're not it. And you see, the tragedy of Marco Polo is some people are playing a permanent role as it in the game of life, that they are blinded. And they're calling out, Marco, Marco, waiting for someone to shout out, over here, this is the way you should go. Truth is over here. Happiness is over here. Success is over here. Wealth is over here. Great health is over here. And they, Marco, how tragic. And they continue to lunge in the direction of these things, and they whack their head against the pool. And instead of going, this is a ridiculous game, I'm not doing it anymore, they will continue to play, wipe the blood off their forehead. Marco! Marco! Are you playing Marco Polo? Are you it in a big, cruel game of Marco Polo? Are you in darkness or are you in the light? Are you in the light? Is your spiritual eyes open? Are you in the Word of God? Is the Holy Spirit leading you? Can you see where life is going? Or are you in complete darkness and you're letting the news and all sorts of media and the internet and people from work and everybody giving you all these different directions when you could simply say enough, take the blindfold off and go, I'm coming to the light. I'm coming to the source of light. I'm coming to the source of life. I'm opening my eyes. You can. You can stop this silly game of Marco Polo anytime you choose. You just have to be sick enough of the darkness to take off the blindfold, because the problem is we're proud in our nature. And what we want to do is keep stumbling around, going, oh, it's my life. I'm going to figure out how to do it. Don't you think it's ironic that we play this game of Marco Polo knowing that we're blinded and we're waiting for other people to tell us where to go and what to do and how to live, instead of taking the blindfold off, removing all obscurity and letting God tell us how to go, where to be, what to do, how to live? I just find that ironic about our nature, that our pride stops us from doing what's best for us. But we choose to do what we want because this sense of independence is so incredibly important to us, rather than living a good, healthy life. Sure, God had to tell you how to do it. What's the harm in that? Or do you think it's better to let someone else who hasn't got a clue what they're doing with their life, they're playing their own little secret game of Marco Polo, tell you what to do? Or the God of creation, the God who created you, the God who knows the beginning from the end? Why do we leave ourselves in darkness, trusting those who could be tormenting and misleading us, rather than trusting the God who does know us and does know what's best for us? You see, you can be a Christian and still in darkness. That's true. You can add Jesus to your life. You can add church to your life. You can add Bible study to your life. You might even want to add ministry to your life. You could be very, very involved in the church and still in darkness. Because you have to be born again. That's what Jesus Christ said. You must be born again. Now, born again is repentance. It is putting to death one life, a life of darkness, and moving into the light, taking on life. And if you don't repent, that's just not saying sorry. Plenty of people say, oh God, I'm sorry, I've sinned. Repentance is going that step further and turning away from that sin, putting away the ways of darkness, putting it off from you and walking toward the light, living in light. So my recommendation, friends, take the blindfold off, open your eyes and see the light. Walk in the light. Live in the light. Quit that ridiculous game of blind man's bluff or Marco Polo and be born again. If you're born again, you've got the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, confirming that you are a child of God. No preacher can give it to you. No pastor can give it to you. No priest. Nobody can give it to you. You either have it or you do not have it. And if you do not have it, you can have it today. But that's your choice. You can continue playing your game and live in darkness, or today you could choose to let in the light and walk in the light, leave the darkness alone. Let the light of a new day dawn on your life. His mercies are new every single day to you. The thing about the sunlight is, I find it fascinating. I've seen quite a few sunrises in my time. Is the way that you go from this pitch black and you can't really see much at all, and just slowly, just incrementally, that sun's coming up on the horizon. It's not at the horizon yet, but the light just projects and it keeps coming and coming and coming, and your visibility is getting better and better and better, and you can see. And even before you see a single ray of light or any warmth from the sun, visibility is getting better and better because you've begun to walk in the light. The light has begun to shine on you. Why don't you turn with me to Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 to 3 says, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. and the Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. So Jesus says that the eye is the light or the lamp of the soul. The eye has the greatest effect on the soul. Yeah, sure, what you hear can have a great effect on your soul, but when the eye is engaged, it's so visual, so visceral, it's so real when you see it. That's why we say, I see it when I believe it. You can hear a million things, but it doesn't necessarily mean you believe it. There's something about sight that's incredible. Today, I think, is a good day for an eye exam, don't you think? I mean, Jesus says, how dark is the light in you? I mean, if you think you're in the light, but you're in fact in the darkness, how would you know it? Isaiah there tells us the light has come. The choice is yours. The responsibility is yours. The joy is yours to step from darkness and into light. Now, the light will expose. That's why we love the darkness. We don't want to be exposed. The light will expose. The light will change you. The light will lead you in a path that you should go. The light will bring accountability. The light will bring you strength. The light will bring you confidence. And it'll be uncomfortable for a while. You can be sure of it. But the light will set you free from fears, from the bounds of confusion, the lack of confidence. The light will bring you freedom. And I say this because God is light. When you not only walk in the light, but you have the light in you through the Holy Spirit, you understand that God is light. And there is no shadow of turning. There is no darkness in God. He is light. Why don't you turn with me to John chapter 8, verse 12, and have a look at what Jesus says here. And Jesus spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. What a fantastic verse. Jesus states very, very clearly there that he is God in the flesh. And if you have Jesus, you have God. Now let's go back to Jesus' first question, that awkward question that we really don't want to address, but have to address. What is the light like inside of you? What is it really like? Is it light or is it darkness? Has shades of darkness begun to move into your world? Is there shadows beginning to form on your roadway? Are you beginning to see, oh my goodness, it's getting dark? Well, praise God that you can see it. That will be the Holy Spirit assisting you in seeing that your world is getting darker and darker. Is the light inside you actually light, or is it actually darkness? Are you the one that Jesus is talking about today? Is it time to stop and reflect and think, my world has become dark? And if your world has become dark, I've got great news. I've got great news. If you will repent today, walk away from darkness and walk into the light, you can be born again. You can know what it's like to walk in light. No more stumbling around in the darkness. Is the Holy Spirit saying, hey, that's you. Hey, are you going to allow God, are you going to give permission for him to touch the things in your life, begin to bring light into those areas that you have so cleverly concealed and covered up, and you think you've been getting away with it, but you're not, because you know it and God knows it. The Holy Spirit's here today, shining a light on your life and saying, you can't see where you're going, but I'll show you the way out if you will just follow me. Have you allowed yourself to become distracted by things in this world, and you're not seeing the light? You've become comfortable in the darkness. Have your eyes adjusted so well to the darkness that you actually think you're in the light? Is it time to take stock and do a bit of an eye examination? If you find yourself in the darkness, I've really only got one recommendation for you. Come into the light. Come into the light, because that's where God is. I'd like to close by looking at one practical outworking of what it really means to walk in the light, because we can talk about in these ethereal terms and unable to put our finger on, well, what would it look like if I was actually living in the light? What would it look like if I was walking in the light? Turn with me to 1 John chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there's no cause for stumbling in him. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Friend, if you believe that you can love God and hate your brother or your sister, you're in darkness. You're so blinded by the darkness, you can't see it. That's what Jesus has said to you here, just in 1 John, and then originally in Matthew chapter 6. You think you're in the light, but you're actually in darkness. You think you're a Christian, but you're not. You can call yourself a Christian all you want. Same way I can call myself a hamburger, it doesn't make me one. You are a born-again believer. You love God if you can love your brother and your sister. That's not like the people that you like. This is love those who are difficult to love. That's what love is. Love's a commitment, not a feeling, not an emotion. Love is a full-on commitment to love those who may not be all that lovable to you, maybe not all that likable. What is church to you, friends? What does church really mean to you? I mean, we talk about church as being not the building but the people. We say it all the time, but do we believe it? Do we really believe it? What is church to you? Is it fellowship? Is it vital? Or is it some sort of religious duty? Is church some sort of a necessary inconvenience or an interruption to your otherwise busy life? If you've ever wondered why I'm so committed to fellowship in the church, this is why. If you're concerned that I seem obsessed with this whole body ministry that we've been talking about in Ephesians 4, this is why. If you want to know why I'm convinced that every member of the body of Jesus Christ is vital to the body of Jesus Christ, this is why. Because this is how we walk in the light. This is how you walk in the light. And look, through your SMPs, I am making it as difficult as possible for you to walk in the darkness. I'm giving you every opportunity through these Sunday ministry points to worship together, to learn and study the Word of God together, to minister to each other, to have fellowship with each other. I'm making sure that through these four facets of our Sunday ministry points, it is as difficult as possible for you to walk in darkness. In fact, the only way you could avoid getting involved in other people's lives is you stop coming. That's why I'm so deliberate about taking this stuff seriously. These Sunday ministry points are for your benefit. It's not an easy way to do church. There are now people who were formerly just congregants sitting in church who are now pastoring. It's a big load for them. This is not an easy decision and it's not an easy load, but it's for your benefit. It's for your benefit that you're in loving, accountable relationships, and these Sunday ministry points are the perfect cauldron for it to happen. You must understand how serious this is. We must learn to love others. Because if we are loving others, we're walking in the light. Sounds so simple, so practical. Not always easy to outwork, because let's face it, not everybody's all that likable. There are difficult people in the world. But we must learn to love them, even if you don't particularly like them. Our love for God must be demonstrated in our love for others. Not just a one-way relationship, but a relationship that goes across to our brothers and sisters in Christ as well. We have to learn to foster love. And your Sunday ministry point is a perfect place for that, because it's a place where you can take an interest in, you can get involved in, and you can have an investment in people's lives who you would on any other Sunday, in any other forum, basically walk past, maybe give the courteous royal wave, and then be on your merry way. Now you have the opportunity to walk in the light. We're going to close in a minute. And in Sunday ministry points, we're going to have a couple of opportunities. First of all, if you're not yet a Christian, you're not born again, truly not born again, you've never given your life to God. I'm going to explain it very quickly to you. This is what we call the gospel. The gospel is simple, three components. First of all, we're sinners. All of us are sinners. You, me, everybody in the room with you, sinners. We acknowledge that we're sinners. Then we acknowledge that Jesus Christ died to pay for our sins, because the Bible tells us the penalty for sin is death, eternal separation from God. But Jesus Christ loved you so much that he gave his own life that you could be born again. So you acknowledge that you're a sinner. You accept Jesus' payment for your sin, and then you repent. Remember, I just spoke about that before. That's the turning away. It's not about continuing living your life your way, but you've now put Jesus in your backpack and you'll turn up to church every now and then. This is a turning around of your life to walk in the light, to get to know God, get to love God, get to serve God, become part of the fellowship, the body of Christ. That is what it means to be born again. That might be you today, and if that's you, I pray you go and see your Sunday ministry point leader and say, I want to be born again. Someone else in the room might be a Christian, but the truth is, you've realized this morning, the fact is, I think I'm in the light, but there's a lot of darkness in my life. There's a lot of shadows where I've put up these little things that shouldn't be in my life, and you know there's darkness, and you need to acknowledge it, confess it, not to anybody in the room, but confess it to God. Accept again his payment for your sin, and then you commit. I mean, you commit to turn from that thing today and walk in the light. Maybe for some of you, you're struggling with this Sunday ministry point transition, because the fact is, it's difficult to be close to people. Maybe you don't want people to know you, and you don't want to know people. That's not healthy, friends. You're part of a body, and this is a necessary transition for you. It's good for you. You're probably the reason that we're here, why God has given us this new model, this new method of way, this way of doing it, so that people like you don't stay on the fringe and eventually fall away. It draws you back into where you're meant to be, back into the light, back into fellowship, back into learning how to love others. This is an opportunity for you and for me, friend, to walk in the light, to walk in the life of Christ. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for the simplicity, but the impact that your word has on our lives. And Lord, it's our desire today to walk in the light. And so inviting you, Holy Spirit, to begin to stir in us. First of all, a desire to walk in the light and to walk out of the darkness. It's not going to happen instantly. You don't do it for us. You call us out and we must follow. And so, Lord, grant us this morning the ability, the courage to leave behind the darkness and begin to walk in the light, especially not just in those moral sins or secret sins, but in particular in the instance of our church, Lord, that those of us who have got issues with others, that we would choose to walk in the light and deal with our issues. Maybe go and apologize to someone for a grudge that you've held against them. Go and sit and have a coffee with someone and see how you can deal with your issues. Lord, grant us wisdom today as we break up into our Sunday ministry points and minister to each other and pray with each other. Lord, bless our time of fellowship also. Maybe a binding time, maybe a time where we get together and just incrementally walk closer and closer with each other, moving further and further into the light. So thank you, Lord, for the work that you're going to do right now in our Sunday ministry points. Holy Spirit, do a miraculous work, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So church, break up in your Sunday ministry points. Begin to minister to each other, love each other, pray with each other. Enjoy your time of fellowship afterwards. Encourage and invest in each other. You're looking after your own body. When you look after others, because we're all part of the same body, you're looking after yourself as well. So may the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you and be merciful to you. May he lift his countenance towards you and bring you peace. May the name of the Lord be upon you, and all who see you see the blessing of the Lord on your life. And may all who observe your life be drawn to God. May they look at your life and say, oh, that's what a Christian looks like. And may that be a compelling draw drawing people out of the darkness and into the light. So, church, I bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. For me, goodbye. Have a wonderful week, and I'll see you again next week. Goodbye. God bless.